Hello, class. Welcome back. This time we're doing a chapter, was it 17, the contemporary period. We're talking about Ludwig Wittgenstein, very important philosopher, Jacques Derrida, and Don Rawls. We probably won't be talking much about Appiah, Mosbon, or MLK. I'm sure MLK, y'all know or heard about that everywhere, so. Let's focus first on the Wittgenstein, Derrida, and then Rawls. Okay. So Ludwig Wittgenstein. I'm not gonna go into his family. I'm just gonna say he's from Vienna. He's German. Very, very rich family. Super. He's a genius from the kid. It's reported that at the age of 10, he created a sewing machine out of matchsticks. So he's a genius since the beginning. But his main interest is in philosophy, is in the philosophy of language, the analysis of language. According to Wittgenstein, most philosophical problems can be traced to the misuse of language, to the confusion of how we use language in everyday life. So Wittgenstein believed that language, if we clarify our confusion with language, we could give a picture of language. The language gives us a picture of reality and that could correspond to the state of affairs, to what's really happening. But we don't know what's really happening. We cannot explain reality because we're not using language the right way. Right? So he was trying to get to a logical construction, right? To the logical form of language. That was his thing. The logical structure of language. That was his main goal. We got to clarify and get to that. Once we have a right understanding of how language functions, how it works, this problem, this philosophical problems will dissolve. Moreover, he believed that we just have to talk about, can forget about talking about metaphysics and ethics, because that we cannot really talk about. Right? It's just, it's transcendent. So we just should stick to scientific propositions. So he was trying to find this perfect language that will be able to picture the world as it corresponds to reality. And this is known as a picture theory of language, which he developed. Wittgenstein. Picture theory of meaning. Sorry. The picture theory of meaning. And this theory, he developed it in his very famous groundbreaking work called The Logical Tractatus. Wrote it while he was in prison in Italy during World War I or World War II? One of those wars. World War I, 1914. That's right. Published it in 1921. So the Tractatus Logico Philosophicus. all right. So Wittgenstein, right? So language is the main thing, and this Tractatus, as we call it now, just Tractatus, he's trying to show this logical structure of language that relates to the world. His central idea is that language is made up of propositions, and that propositions have a logical structure, a way to their components are linked to one another. So A is B and B is C, thus A equals C. Propositions, for example. Right? And this structure of propositions corresponds to the world structure, to how the world is structured, or reality, to the facts or state of affairs is causal, or reality. So in this way, true propositions picture the facts. Right? They say how things are. Just like like in music, right? The music, the notes, right? They give us a picture of the whole, I guess, score, right? As we play it along, right? Each note is like individual, just like each word. But once you do the whole thing, it's a composition, you see the whole score, right? Kind of like that. It's trying to, kind of like that for a little bit. So yeah. But just as a picture has something in common with that, which is pictures, so language has a logical form in common with the world it pictures. However, this logical form is usually obscured by ordinary language. So the philosopher's job is to clear up ordinary language by crafting, by creating this language that more perfectly pictures the world. So this perfected language, this perfect language that he tries to create by finding the logical structure of it, will have to exclude many propositions, such as those in ethics, metaphysics, or religion. That what cannot be said clearly. That's what he says in the Tractatus. So this kind of gives rise to this whole Vienna circle of this logical positivist. So like Wittgenstein, they all work on an ideal language. They're trying to find this ideal language that maps out the world, that pictures the world for us, that corresponds to the reality at hand for us. So it's all about logic here, right? So that's what they call the logical positivist, right? They're trying to find the logical language so that they could better map out, picture the world with this logical language, this perfected language, right? This is the so-called Vienna Circle. And people like Rudolf Carnap, who was the antithesis of Martin Heidegger, had like this big debate going on. They hated each other. And why? Because Martin Heidegger is all about metaphysics, right? Talking about this being and Dasein. The fuck does it mean, right? It has no, right? So it's not a reality. And Rudolf Carnap is like, no, let's talk about, you know, logical structure of language. That's what reality is. Fuck the Dasein. So yeah, so the Vienna Circle, right? It's just the logical structure of language. But that's the early Wittgenstein. Right, Wittgenstein, there's a story that goes that he was in this train ride, and he was kind of having this existential crisis at the time. And one of his friends, Straffa, jokingly gave him this right here, this gesture, which, like I said, in French, means basically like the middle finger. Right, you kind of go like that, you brush your fingers below your neck against somebody. And he was like, what the fuck? Like, what does that map out? What is that picture? What is this phrase picture? What logical language can, what perfect language can that picture? What, it doesn't fit, right? He just couldn't find that logical structure for this gesture. And he had an aha moment. He's like, whoa, shit, I've been wrong all along. Like, the point here is not to find a perfect language, because that doesn't fucking exist. The point here is to find how language is used on our everyday life. Again, going back to context, if you saw my last lecture on feminist philosophers, right, and as a matter of fact, Wittgenstein was a big influence on the way that feminist philosophers formulated their epistemologies, a way of knowing, right, by this, right, by language, how language is used, right, does give us the way to know the world. So if you don't know what it means, right? You, like in some countries, this means something bad. For us, it's like, okay, right? It's a good thing. But some other countries, it means something bad, right? And this is what he calls, Wittgenstein calls, language games. We need to know what, like a game. Think about a game. What each game has its own set of rules, right? Soccer is very different from football. Although, I don't know why they call football, or you use your hand all the time, where in soccer you use your foot all the time. And that's different rules, right? For those different. So to understand football, you got to understand the basic rule that you use your hand, right? And to understand soccer, you got to understand the basic rule that you got to use your foot. You can't use your hands unless you're the goalie, right? So same with language, right? There's no perfect language out there. There's no one logical, perfect language that can understand, picture the world for us. We can understand how the game of each language is being used. The language, the context of each proposition is going to give us the picture of reality that Wittgenstein is trying to get. Well, Wittgenstein, you pronounce it with a V, these German W's. Right? So language gets its meaning not from some mysterious essence, It's this logical structure of language, the word of the fuck that is, right? But from how it is used in a particular context. A language game is a pattern of human activity in which words play a crucial role and derive their meaning from how they're used in the activity. And how the context, you know, whether it's actual verbal or nonverbal cues, right? All that has particular meaning. You can't find just one perfect logical language that's going to picture the whole world for us. That's impossible. That's later Wittgenstein. So Wittgenstein is divided into the early logical positivists, where we can find this logical. That's the whole goal for him. And then later it's like, whoa, I was wrong. It's about these language games, this particular context of how language is being used. That's going to tell me reality. All right. Now let's move on to Jacques Derrida. This guy's a French guy. He was actually born in Algiers, just like Albert Camus. Remember Camus? He's also an existentialist, the guy, the absurd, philosophy of the absurd, the myth of Sisyphus. Jacques Derrida was born in 1930. Died in 2004, and he is credited with coming up with this method. Really, it's just a method. It's not really a philosophy, but a method of deconstruction. And I kind of mentioned this in the last lecture as well. Right, so there's a lot of overlaps between chapters 16 and 17. This is a contemporary period, both feminists and these thinkers here. So basically, Derrida's goal is to critique this notion of structuralism. Structuralism just basically says that the way that words are structured is going to give you the meaning of the of everything. But Derrida says, like, no, there's like, you got to read between the lines. Like, yes, there is, like, the way words are structured is going to give you some meaning, but also within that text, it's going to give you some ulterior, I guess, other meaning that was kind of like subconsciously there, but we're not aware. Right? So think about, again, Derrida was also influential in feminist thinking. Think about the epistemology of the I, the cogito. For most of history, the I is always in the male perspective. It's an autonomous, rational, thinking being. And what I just talked about in the last lecture, it's like, no, there's also this other ways of knowing that don't have to be autonomous and rational. They could be interdependent about caring and about community and about love, joy, and stuff like that, and hate even. So the same thing here, right? But here with the text, right? So Derrida's all about the writing, right? The language, the written form has this hidden text in it that we need to deconstruct. So he claimed that the very nature of a written text, of every traditional text, not just the structuralist, but every text out there, undermines itself. To deconstruct a text, then, is to dismantle inherent hierarchical systems of thought, to seek out unregarded details, to find the margins of the text, where there are new possibilities of interpretation. Pretty heady stuff here, right? It's hermeneutics here, 101, the best hermeneutics. Hermeneutics is the method of interpretation. It's taking the name hermeneutics is taken from the Greek myth of Hermes, who was the messenger between the gods and humans. And he would interpret the messages from God, and sometimes we'll mess around with the humans sometimes. But it's about interpretation. Right, so you're trying to find the truth, meaning, right, what the gods told you to humanity, right? So you think in this myth, hermeneutics, now instead of God, it's like the truth, and then the interpretation of us humans trying to get to that truth. And of course, he's a postmodernist, so there is no truth. It's multiple, right? It's always fluid. It's not static, right? So for him, his main idea, and it makes sense for where he comes from. He comes from a colony, a French colony, Algiers, right, from the margins of the empire, where Paris is the center, right. So for him, is the margins, right. He's always interested between the relationship between the margin and the center, the periphery in the core. Right? And you can flip those things, right, to find the real answer, right? So he's always like, he's also a Hegelian in that sense. So let's talk about his philosophy, because he's a pretty important guy, deconstruction, Derrida. So his most famous book is called Of Grammatology, right? Of the study of grammar, right? Of grammatology. Derrida here calls out what he calls logocentrism, right? Logocentrism is our preoccupation with truth, logic, and rationality that characterizes our Western intellectual tradition. Right? Just like there's Eurocentrism, right, where everything is centered around Europe, or European ways of knowing, he also has this thing called logocentrism, that this obsession with logic and rationality, right, is a detrimental for philosophy as a whole. So Derrida says that these that deconstruction, right, that language, right, it's not this perfect thing, it's fluid. Language, that the meanings of in language, the meanings are slippery. There is no definite meaning for a certain word. Right? Think about content and content. Right? If you read it in the text, content or content, it's the word, same word, but different meanings, right? Or even within the same, if we do have the same, like, I guess, same meaning, right? Content. It might mean different things to different people, being content. Does that make sense? I hope it does, right? So let me go on here. So words and their meanings are not firmly moored to the world, not rooted in the world. They are free-floating and changeable, right? Words and their meanings. Right, words are not static or fixed. Language is fluid, right? This is a very postmodernist way of thinking. So philosophy, right, thus far, since up to this point, pretty much, thinks that it can talk about meaning through a language unsullied by the imprecisions of metaphors. Right, so the thing about early Wittgenstein, right, this finding this perfect language that could picture the world for us. He says, no, au contraire. Right? He's French. Au contraire, says Derrida. Derrida argues in our selection, Derrida argues that philosophical discourse, there's a privilege that we have here. We privilege certain texts, certain ways of certain languages, certain ways of expressing ourselves. The philosophical discourse, right, is a has certain privileges within itself, and that these privileges within itself undermine itself. Okay, so let me kind of tell you exactly from the horse's mouth here, I guess. The signifiers of language, the words, the meanings, right, what gives me significance, right, the signifiers of language, cannot refer to a transcendental signified originating in the speaker. Because this signified, right? So the reference and the referent. Right, this is Frege. This is one of the first guys that pioneered the philosophy of language. So Frege has this idea of there's the referent, the object that we're trying to refer to, and the reference. So when I say pencil or mechanical pencil here, right? I have the reference, mechanical pencil, and then the actual object, the referent. Same thing here with the signified and the signifier. The signifier is a word that I use, and the signified, is the object, right? The signifier, the expression, and the signified. So I, the word I. The signifier is that letter I, right? It looks like that. And the signified is I, me, this person here, okay? So in language, right, the structural is believe in that thing, that the signified gives you this, the signifier, right, the symbol will give you the signified. The relationship here is signifier and then correlates to the signified. Derrida breaks that relationship here, the structuralist built, right? So he says,
The signifiers of language systems cannot refer to a transcendental signified originating in the mind of the speaker, because this signified is itself created by the conventional and hence arbitrary signifiers of language. Signifiers, therefore, merely refer to other signifiers. For example, words refer only to other words. The meaning, quote unquote, is always deferred. Presence, right, the actuality of what we're trying to say, the signified, is never actually present. Signifiers attain significance only in their differences from each other, or in what they define themselves against. Right? For example, cat. The word cat is different from car. Very, very similar, but totally different things, right? And that's how we get the meanings of these two different words, is the difference between those two things. Not that there's the signifier car and then the signified object out there, car out there somewhere, transcendent. No, right? It's not Platonic at all. It's going against Platonism, right? It's postmodernist, right? It's just, you know, it's just the differences or the, what he says here, how they define themselves against other concepts. For example, to be asleep means totally different than to be awake. But we know those differences, we know those meanings between those differences of those two things. Not because there's a awakeness out there and a sleepness out there. No, it's just the differences between those two. And this is like language for Derrida. So what he's trying to do is to highlight the ambiguities of language. The language is ambiguous, but it's not perfect. And thus, right, we're not going to be able to picture, as a logical positivist say that we will, with this perfect logical language. There is no such thing. It's fluid. It's not fixed. Right, so this is what he calls, right, this way of meaning, to make meaning via difference of, like I said, car and cat. Right? We know the meaning not because there's a car out there or a cat out there in abstract reality, just because there's different in everyday reality. Right? He calls that difference. Right? It's a French word that he coins, difference. And it means both to differ and to defer. Right? The difference defers the meaning of something, right? It's within the differences that gives things meaning. That's Derrida. Right? And then he goes on to say that all these systems of thought, of languages, contain within themselves, or within them, these traces of that which they define themselves against. And this is what we could deconstruct to find these ulterior subconscious texts, he calls. So deconstruction is a way of unpacking a text, right? Whether it's philosophy or whatever, to reveal hidden assumptions and contradictions that subvert the apparent meaning of that text. It's deconstruction here. So think about the binaries, right, of like slave and master in Hegel, right, or proletariat in bourgeoisie in Marx, or white and black, right, racist thinking, or truth and fiction, right. We usually tend, right, to polarize our thinking in these binaries, right. This is like the Western tradition for some reason, a way of making sense of the world. We always use these binaries. Right, this is what he calls the logocentrism, trying to be rational, kind of puts us in this binary way of thinking. Right, literal and metaphorical, right, reality versus appearance. Right, in the Western tradition, the left hand, right, the first part, right, truth is better than fiction. Right, the literal, is better than the metaphorical. Or reality, right, the left-hand side, whatever you're seeing here, the first part is better than the second part, right? This is like the Western tradition that we break things down. Via deconstruction, right, we could see these privileges, right? We will see these hidden meanings between these two texts, right? We could often flip it around, where the right-hand term, the second term, is actually, right, what he says is like, you know, they both depend on each other. So they both could be primary and secondary. Okay. Basically, the overall strategy for Derrida is to turn the philosophical or literary text against itself. Okay. Turn the text against itself. And it's a method of interpretation. Okay. All right. That's enough of Derrida. Derrida is kind of hard to fucking understand and to translate. He actually like goes against conventional languages and creates kind of like his own language, right? So it's really hard to read. Like, you start reading Afghan mythology, he has like a word and he crosses it out to say that the word is really non-existent and stuff. It's just, he has a really great, crazy way of thinking. Okay. But deconstruction is his main philosophy, main method. Let's talk about John Rawls, right, really quickly now. So John Rawls, he was born in 1921, he died in 2002. He is definitely the most important political philosopher for the Anglo-American world, for here in the U.S. He was born in Baltimore, he went to Princeton, he taught there at Princeton, he taught there at Cornell, then at MIT, then at Harvard. Brilliant guy, brilliant, but he's all about political philosophy, okay? That's a good thing about, I guess, before we go into Rawls itself, let's talk about, I guess, different isms in philosophy, right? So we have, let's talk about political terminology here. We have liberalism, and this is really what Rawls falls under, generally, liberalism, in the broader sense. He's more often called, he's more of the welfare liberalism, but liberalism is the political theory that emphasizes the liberal and rights of individuals against the encroachments by the state. So in this sense, in this broad sense, both liberals, right, or those on the right or the left, and the right are liberals, right? Because they emphasize liberty against the encroachments of the state. Whether you're a Democrat or a Republican, they both have, right? You can call yourself a liberal. That's what liberalism means. That you're about liberty, liberalism. Right? It's its own word right there. However, I don't know, liberalism now today means that you're part of the Democratic Party, which is not quite true, but that's the tradition here in the U.S. Okay, now we have welfare liberalism. And this is the view that a just society, right, a society that has justice, that's distributed equally, right, justice, aims to preserve individual liberties, however, it still ensures the overall welfare of that citizenry, of that society. So welfare liberalism is like, yes, we have individual liberties, but also importantly is the overall welfare of everybody. Whereas in just classical liberalism, it's just liberties and rights you have to defend against the state. Then we have libertarianism, or what's known as classical liberalism, as we said, the doctrine that emphasizes personal freedoms and rights to pursue one's own benefits, one's own social and economic well-being, in the so-called free market, without interference from others. So it's libertarianism is just you're free to do what you want to benefit yourself. You don't have to. You don't have to care about the welfare of others at all. Socialism. The political and economic view that the means of production, we talked about this in the Hegel and Marxist chapter, so the means of production is the property, the factories, the businesses, should be owned and controlled by the state for the general welfare of all. And here the state should be understood as is run by the people, it's run by the workers. In socialism, the workers equals the state. There's no politicians, right? It's the workers. Capitalism, a social economic system in which wealth goes to anyone who can acquire it in the free marketplace. It's capitalism. Free for all, basically. So let's go talk about Rawls, right? So Rawls, interesting character, very influential, like I said, here in the U.S. And to say why. So his masterpiece of political philosophy is this book called A Theory of Justice. It's published in 1971. All right, and this theory of justice, this book, he proposes a kind of theory that he first says that, you know, our socioeconomic status, our characters, our behaviors, are accidents of nature, he says, right? My class, my gender, right? All these things I'm talking about, right? Class, gender, sexuality, these are kind of like accidents, right? Nobody really chose that, right? Nobody really chose to be born poor in a poor family household. Well, nobody really chose to be born in a wealthy family, right, for example. These are just kind of like accidents that happen. Therefore, right, since these characters and behaviors are acts of nature, no one really deserves any particular allotment of benefits or burdens. And so equality is the most reasonable basis for the distribution of goods, for the distribution of justice, equality. So egalitarianism, right? So what Rawls views here, right, is a kind of social contract theory that we're going to create. So think about, you know, Hobbes and Rousseau, we talked about way earlier in the semester, right? So a social contract theory says that justice is secured and the state is made legitimate through an agreement, right, among the citizens. But this contract theory, though, what's really important in this contract theory for Rawls is its origins, the beginning, the first original principles, what he calls the original position of this contract theory. If that is fair and equitable, then the rest, what pops out from the social contract theory, should be also fair and equitable. That's the way he sees this, the social contract theory. Right, this initial position of equality, he says, if we have this initial position of equality when we first make contract theory, this contract between us, the social contract, then the rest of society, whatever pops up, blooms from this contract, is going to be equitable. Right. So Rawls began with this hypothetical starting point, this thought experiment. He says, okay, imagine if we're back at square one, right, the original position where we're going to lay out a social contract, okay, among us. So he says, in order to ensure, right, a fair and impartial and as possible contract between individuals that are rational, self-interested, and normal, right? Is everybody, right? Everybody is rational, at least for him. Everybody is self-interested. Everybody's looking out for their own benefit, their own survival. So in order to make a social contract theory that's the most equitable and for him the most just as possible, we have to go behind this metaphorical veil of ignorance. We have to don a veil, right? We have to cover ourselves with this ignorance. What does that mean? This veil of ignorance? What does that say? So behind this veil of ignorance, no one knows his or her own social or economic status, class, race, sex, abilities, talents, levels of intelligence, or psychological makeup. Right? We don't know about that. We just donned this veil of ignorance to not know any of those things. Thus, everybody's equal. Everybody kind of has the same equal starting point. And because, since these participants are rational, self-interested, but ignorant of their situation, of their positionality in society, they would not agree to any principles that will put any particular group at a disadvantage or advantage. Right? The assumption here is that since the negotiating conditions of the original positions are fair, the agreements reached will also be fair. The principles will be just. Right? So this self-ignorance. Right? So when you go to when we create a social contract, we have got to go behind this veil of ignorance, not know what my position in society is, and thus everybody has that veil of ignorance. Whatever principles we make is going to be the most fair and the most just, because we don't know if we're going to be poor or not or rich, right? We have this ignorance, so we're going to want what's best for everyone involved. Okay. That's Rawls liberalism, way of welfare liberalism, right, to do that, basically. So for him, right, he doesn't believe in libertarianism, right? He doesn't, his principle is more of a principle of egalitarianism, right, of equality, whereas libertarianism functions under the principle of entitlement, right? Libertarians argue that even if people don't deserve the goods they have, they nevertheless may be entitled to them. So for example, on the most basic level, we are entitled, says the libertarians, to the self-ownership of my bodies, even though I didn't choose this body. Right. So even though people don't deserve the goods that they have, they might be entitled to those goods, nonetheless. The principle of entitlement, that this is what libertarianism kind of falls under. Okay. So Robert Nozick is one of the most famous proponents or philosophers of the libertarian position, Robert Nozick. He argues that if we rightfully possess any goods, they are ours only because we are entitled to them, because we acquired them legitimately, not because we got them through appeals to equality or desert. Right? So he's about libertarianism. It's like, I work for my own goods, so I deserve those goods. I should not give those up for anybody else. Right? It's not because I'm not being run here by some basis of equality or necessity. No, it's my own benefit. This is Robert Nozick. Right, and then you have John Rawls on the other side. This guy, John Rawls, who is the welfare liberal. Like, he's like, no. Like, we need to make sure that everybody has, you know, that justice is equally distributed to everybody. And this does mean, you know, perhaps taxing the wealthy so they could help out the needy, the poor. Right? Redistributing resources. Right? This might be a thing that has to happen, according to Rawls, in order to reach a more just and equitable society. So he's under the principle of egalitarianism. Right? He wants equality. All right. Quickly, just going to talk about Appiah, Kwame Anthony Appiah, just because he's still alive. He ended up going to New York University, New York NYU Law, or NYU in general. You'll probably take some classes with him. It's pretty awesome. He actually came to El Paso a couple of years back, too. And his interest is broad, right? From theory to praxis, right? From theory to the actual practice of his theory. But one of his main principles or theories or concepts is his theory of cosmopolitanism, right? So he's very concerned about how in this globalized world, all these different tribes and clans and different people are constantly gonna be interacting with each other, right? And friction is gonna be a natural outcome of this interaction of different strangers coming together. Think about, well, before the pandemic hit, think about like going into an airport and just sit there, right, waiting for your plane for maybe an hour, right? You got delayed for an hour. Just sit there for an hour, and you're going to see people passing from all different parts of the fucking world, basically. Especially like a big airport like LAX or JFK in New York, right? Or the Atlanta airport is fucking huge as well, right? Just sit there for an hour, you're going to see people from, or maybe even meet people from all different parts of the world, right? And his main is like, how can we find harmony when so many differing people clash? And his answer is this concept of cosmopolitanism. So what is cosmopolitanism? It comes from the ancient Greek words cosmo and polis. Cosmos means the universe, and polis means a city, right? So he says that, you know, we should think about the world as one big city, right? And with that, right? What Appiah is trying to emphasize here is the oneness of all humanity. The humanity is at the end, yes, we're different. We have different tribes, different clans, different languages, different cultures, etc., and so on. But at the end of the day, we are just one human family, one human city, right? Cosmopolitanism, right? The citizen of the cosmos, right? I'm not a citizen of the U.S., right? It's trying to break away from these nationalistic tendencies, right, that give rise to nativism and prejudices. America, number one. So no. I'm a citizen of the cosmos. Right, we're all citizens of the cosmos. Right, that's his idea of breaking away from these frictions when we encounter the other. Okay, so a recognition of the oneness of humanity, of universal kingship, beyond the narrow concerns of a single group. For Appiah, cosmopolitanism is the idea that we have significant moral duties to all persons, even those outside our families and community. Right, you have to have respect for this diversity and be part of this, the cosmos, right? So that's basically your Appiah, what I want to say. Do you want to talk about Miles more? Yeah. Martha Nussbaum also comes out in this chapter. She's pretty important, I guess, too. Her big thing is that she's always, it's about praxis. That every theory that you make up, your next question should be, how would the world look like if I apply this theory? Right. So the application of philosophical theories is her main concern, right? So apply the ethics, right? And it's all about, you know, also she's an egalitarianist. It's about equality and justice and stuff like that. So she comes up, but she's kind of follows or develops this so-called equal respect principle. We got to have equal respect for everybody, right? So she's broad. She writes about all kinds of different subjects, from law, right, to homosexuality, to all kinds of things, right? It's all about that, basically. But having equal respect for everybody, right? Just respect everybody equally. Doesn't matter the differences. Right. And then the last one that this book talks about in this chapter is Elmo K. And of course, right, nonviolence resistance, that's his main thing, right, taken from Gandhi. And yeah, I'm not really going to talk much about that. What I'm going to say is that there is this confusion about Elmo K. Right? Like recently, people have been talking about that Elmo K would not do that. Elmo K would not violently protest. Elmo K was about nonviolence. That is true. He did espouse and he did promote and write about nonviolence resistance, but it didn't mean that he didn't protect himself. As a matter of fact, historical fact, MLK House, this house he lived in Birmingham, Alabama for a while, was an arsenal of the civil rights movement. In his basement, he had a bunch of fucking machine guns, grenades. It was an arsenal. So yes, he did espouse nonviolence resistance, but he was not dumb enough to not protect himself because they were under constant fire. As a matter of fact, his home got bombed a couple of times. And he had brothers with arms and machine guns as well. Right? So we have this view, this mainstream narrative that MLK is like this pacifist that will not pick up a gun. He would shoot you if he had to. Although that was not his main strategy. Right? It's a big difference between strategies and a way of life and reality, right? For him, the strategy that he think would work best was nonviolence. But that was a strategy. To survive for him, he had to have guns around him in protection. And what killed him at the end of the day? What killed him on April 4th, 1968? A fucking gun, right? So yeah. So that's all I want to say about MLK, right? Just, I'm going to clarify this image of him as being this nonviolent pacifist. He did promote nonviolence, but as a basic survival reality of his life, he was well enmeshed with guns, right? He did protect himself. Like I said, his house was an arsenal during this time period. All right. There is another chapter in this book. I'm not really concerned about that. You can read it on your own if you want to or not. Basically, it just kind of tries to put everything together that we learned and how to apply it in our everyday life, how all these different theories are either optimistic or pessimistic, how there's different meanings to life. Right? But that's up to you. I'm not going to make you make your own meaning to your own life. Right? So that's why I don't really go over chapter 18. That's up. That's all on you. But anyways, that's it. Thank you so much for this odd semester. This online thing was thrust upon us. Not a fan of it at all. But I really hope you guys enjoy these little lectures here. All right. I know they were fucking long, but all right. All right. You guys be safe. And my email is available to y'all. You know, if you guys didn't have any questions beyond this class about anything, hit me up. I'm always open. Okay. So be safe. Take care. Thank you so much for everything.